1 Timothy. We're in 1 Timothy this evening. We were in portions of 1 Timothy not too long ago in Sunday school class. And one of the things that I realized when I preached through books of the Bible is that you can't preach everything, but that at the same time, you know, you really want to get back sometimes to places where you've looked over some important material that really is helpful. Like preaching the epistles in the Scripture, like preaching the Gospels in the Scripture, like preaching the prophets in the Scripture, like preaching all the books of the Bible because of the whole counsel of God. I don't like preaching Song of Solomon, and so I don't do that very often. But other than that, I enjoy preaching the Word of God. When I get a geriatric crowd, and I'm geriatric, we're going to do a big study on Song of Solomon, and I'll probably be, you know, my mid-80s, maybe 90 or so. And we're really going to have a look at that book and find out what it's all about. Until then, I avoid it. And just saying that because I like the looks of shock on everybody's faces. And you feel the same way. I better not catch you reading that. 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter 1. And we'll read this evening down to verse 4, or verse 5 really. If we were to read the whole text, the whole context, we'd read the first chapter because it's all, the introductory material gets right to the point and it's all, the first point is right in the first chapter. We'll read verses 1 through 5 and then we'll ask the Lord's help this evening. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the commandment of God our Savior, and Lord Jesus Christ, which is our hope. Unto Timothy, my own son in the faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. As I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus when I went into Macedonia, that thou mightest charge some that they teach no other doctrine, neither give heed to fables and endless genealogies, which minister questions, rather than godly edifying which is in faith, so do. Now the end of the commandment is charity of a pure heart and of a good conscience and of faith unfeigned. Our Heavenly Father, we do thank you this evening for doctrine that is sound, and Father, that any person who wants to know can come to the realization of. And I thank you, Father, for warnings against false doctrine in the Scripture so that we don't have any excuse for ignoring false doctrine or for going off into it ourselves. And I ask that you would help us to see these matters plainly from the Scripture. And Father, I ask that you would not only help us to see them from the Scripture, but with your help, Father, help us to be pure in heart. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I love the epistles, in particular when Paul gives an address and makes a reference to his calling as an apostle. And so we don't want to just jump over an important greeting because greetings are important, and there's some important material here. Paul begins, first of all, by pointing out that he is an apostle of Jesus Christ. Now, we know that Jesus chose his apostles. He chose those individuals that followed him. And it's interesting, an apostle and a disciple, there is a distinction between the two. A disciple would be a follower of Jesus who would have 24/7 have been with Jesus physically present every day. For those individuals that try to teach discipleship salvation, or salvation by following Jesus, by taking up the cross, if you will, and following him. For those individuals, I think something that you would find uncomfortable is that discipleship is not mentioned outside of the Gospels, and it's not mentioned outside of the book of Acts, where the disciples were given final instructions. You don't find a reference to disciples at all throughout the rest of the New Testament. And the reason for that is because the call to be a disciple is a call that is to be physically present with the Lord Jesus. Jesus is in heaven, and so I'm going to practice discipleship when I get to heaven. And until then, I'm just going to practice conformity to the image of Jesus Christ and being led by God's Holy Spirit. Now, I don't want to make too much out of that this evening, but if you'll take the time to study it, you'll find that there are some things that bear consideration that maybe will help you with some doctrine that many people struggle over that's very simple to come to an understanding of. But Paul does here mention that this distinct calling that he has to be an apostle And of course, we know that his time is limited. He is in the age of the apostles, in the era of the apostles. An apostle was an individual who was a foundational gift to the church because, if you'll remember, they didn't have the New Testament or the Scripture, and the church was a newly established institution. Salvation had been the same from the beginning of the world. And that's debatable now, too. Individuals argue about whether or not salvation has always been the same. Let's look at the introduction to Titus real quickly, because this just comes to mind. I think it's worth sharing about. It's a similar calling. Titus, just turn over your Bible about 2-3 pages. The Epistle of Paul to Titus. Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ. Again, this calling to be an apostle of Christ. According to the faith of God's elect and the acknowledging of the truth which is after godliness. Then he goes on to say, in hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began. Okay, when did God promise eternal life? Before the world began. This is one of those statements they said to strike from your doctrinal statement, wasn't it? When God had decreed, something like that. You remember that? Somebody gave you, I can't remember the exact something about it, but here's your verse, here's your scripture. Before the beginning of the world. So when was it that the plan for redemption was established? Before man ever even fell. Before the world began. That's what the scripture teaches. And so God has, when God created man with the ability to fall, and he also created him with a redemption plan at the same time. So I just want you to know the character of God in heaven. God in heaven wasn't a cruel individual that instituted sin and made it so that man without choice would go into sin, but God in heaven had a redemption plan for man in the chance that man would fall into sin. Isn't that good that God had a plan? And you know what that plan was? It was the plan that was revealed in the scripture for the first time in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15, that there is going to be from the seed of a woman an individual who is going to be a savior. And by the way, if you don't notice, that is a reference to the virgin birth of Christ. Women don't have a seed. The seed comes from the man, not from the woman. And so it's a reference to the virgin birth of Jesus Christ, which is supernatural. And so I find these things are astounding, just this wonderful, wonderful truth of the Word of God that enlightens us and helps us to understand God's eternal plan for salvation from the foundation of the world. God in heaven has never been in a situation where he's wondered, what will I do now? Man has messed things up, and oh no, what am I going to do? God has always had a plan for redemption. Okay, so let's get back to this idea of the apostle. I'm back in 1 Timothy now, so we're not jumping too far, but just a little bit. But Paul addresses his son in the faith, Timothy, and he references his own call to be an apostle. Again, I was started to mention that the believers at this time had foundational gifts to the church because they didn't have the Word of God. Where do we find the rules for faith and practice of a local church? In other words, we have a document in our church, our rules for faith and practice. We have our doctrinal statement, and anyone here is welcome to see that, study it. I recommend that you do. But where do we find our doctrine?
The Bible.
The Bible. We go to the Bible, to God's Word. Well, where did the church at Ephesus go for their rules of faith and practice? They went to the apostles. Went to the apostles because they didn't have the New Testament of the Scripture. And so I find that the general epistles, the letters to the churches, are very instructive. And the reason for it is because God's Spirit was given in a permanent way, His Word, so that we today could know how to live. And so we don't just pick and choose, denominationally or doctrinally what we believe. We go to the Word of God and discover what we believe. And I want to tell you something. When somebody begins with saying, well, our churches or our denomination's confession of faith, or our churches or our denomination's statement, I just want to tell you what you need to do with that. You just need to throw that out and go find somebody that says, our Bible says, because that is the rule for faith and practice. And the Bible is our doctrinal statement. This is where we arrive at what we believe. And so I want to make a statement right away that I hope will. There's plenty of room right on the front row. We reserved it just for you. I want to make a statement right at the beginning, and that has to do with, I lost my thought. I'm going to get it. I'm not going to let it go. I know it has to do with faith and practice, but that's not it. It's going somewhere.
Apostles.
Now, hold on a second. Let me think. I'll have to move on, and then I'll come back to it when I remember. I was talking about the Word of God. Oh, we have the Word of God. Today we have the Word of God in our church, and the Word of God is where we arrive at our doctrine. But the Apostle Paul is about to give some warnings. I'll just move forward. He's about to give some warnings to Timothy, his son in the faith. And I was going to talk about the epistles. The epistles are a wonderful place to go just to find out what we believe. And here's what I wanted to say a minute ago. That is that doctrine is not something that's debatable. Doctrine is not debatable. By debatable, I mean it's not something that we all hack at and hash at until we arrive at something that suits us. Doctrine is not something that it is okay for you to have your set and me to have my set and for there to be different sets. We as Christians need to come to the place when we recognize that God's intention for us as believers is absolute certainty with regard to His Word. He's written His Word very specifically. He's been so specific as He has given His Word as to tell us that no jot, which is just a little spot, a little marking in the Hebrew language, smaller than a comma, or tittle, just a little quick end marking, no jot or tittle is going to pass from the law till all be fulfilled. The Scripture promises that God's Word is preserved, and I quote 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 20 all the time, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private interpretation. What that means is that the Bible is not to be interpreted this way by this private individual, and this way by this private individual, and another way altogether by another individual. I've had people try to use the application argument with me. They say, well, everybody has different needs. And so the Bible applies to them differently. Friend, the Bible says the same things. The application of the Scripture is different on the basis of what your sin is. It's usually sin is what your need is. And the Scripture applies to you on the basis of your sin. A person who struggles with a particular sin, the particular portions of the Scripture that deal with their sin gives them help. A person who struggles with a particular Bible doctrine or with a particular problem. Maybe, things aren't coming to me right now, but whatever your particular need is, the portion of the Scripture that specifically deals with that applies to you. But it does not say something different to everyone else. It's just that you need it in a more particular way. Do you understand? So your need does not change the interpretation of the Scripture. It simply takes you to the place where you apply it. And we as Christians need to adopt an attitude of absolute certainty with our approach to the Scripture. You say, Pastor, just believe whatever it is I believe. No, find out what the Word of God says and believe it. So we ought to be students when we go to the Scripture. We ought to say, I desire to know truth. And we ought to be open-minded when we go to know truth. most of the time, individuals go to the Scripture so that they can get weapons to use to argue. And they want to twist the Scripture, or they want to wield it, or they want to, as 1 Peter says, rest with the Scripture, or wrestle it, pin it down so that it fits their particular, whatever their particular motive is, or their aim, or what they're trying to accomplish. Christian, that's not the spirit in which we go to the Word of God. Say, Pastor, you talk about that too much. The reason I talk about it so much is as I read the Bible, I find that God's Word talks about it a lot. And so then I find if God emphasizes it, then it must be a matter of importance. And so I won't apologize for that. I think it's important. I believe when you read each of the epistles, I shouldn't say I believe, you read each of the epistles in the New Testament, there is a large portion of material dedicated to warning against false doctrine. Large portion. The reason for it is that it's a dangerous situation. So now here's our setting as Paul pens this letter or epistle to Timothy. Timothy has been left behind, the Scripture says, at Ephesus for the purpose of making sure that they don't start teaching different doctrine. Whereas here's Timothy. He's a guy that has been taught the Scriptures from his youth up. He's been taught personally by the Apostle Paul, and he's just a sound, grounded guy. And Paul's not concerned about Timothy straying doctrinally. And so there are some areas of application this evening. Are you a Timothy? Doctrinally, are you the kind of person that is grounded in what you believe, that you know what you believe and you're not going to stray? Now then there's a warning that Paul says. So verse 3 says, I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus when I went into Macedonia. Here's the reason. For the purpose, or that thou mightest charge some that they teach no other doctrine. So Paul said, I left you behind, and my purpose is that you would charge people. You would give them a charge. You would give them the command that they teach no other doctrine. And he's the watchdog. So here's Timothy, the pastor, and the pastor, the watchdog. And so you find the pastor breathing down your neck or yapping at your heels about doctrine. One of the things I want to remind you about is that's what preachers do. That's what they're commanded to do. It's one of their first and foremost things. You ought to expect from the preacher that he ought to be a person that cares about what the Bible teaches, that contends for the faith. And one of the things you ought to expect about a guy that contends is that sometimes he'll seem a little bit contentious. You go out and be and contend and try not to be contentious sometime, and you let me know how you succeed at it. It's impossible. And so we find this guy Timothy, he's a young man, but he's a grounded guy. He's not a pushover, and he's left there on purpose because of that. So though he's young in the faith, he's grounded in the Scripture, and he's probably a bit of a rascal to deal with if you get off doctrinally, because he knows the Word of God, and he's staying behind to charge men that they teach no other doctrine. So here you have in the Fourth Baptist Church at Ephesus, an assembly of people, and here's Timothy, and he's functioning as their pastor, and he's allowed so-and-so to teach a class, and so-and-so gets up and starts to get off a little bit doctrinally, and Timothy stands up and says, this is what the Scripture says. And because the Scripture says this, and because you're teaching another faith and a doctrine, I'm challenging you to get right about it. Agree with the Word of God. And that person is then faced with a choice. They can agree with the Scripture, or they can be canned. And that's basically Timothy's job in a nutshell. He's to contend for the truth, and he is to be the person that is watching out for it. I don't know if you ever saw Timothy in that light, but study the Scripture, and you'll find that each of the epistles carries with this command for purity in the church. And his job in the church is to watch out for sound doctrine. Now, he goes on to say that another problem that creeps up in the church is that people give heed to fables and endless genealogies. He says, neither give heed to fables and endless genealogies, which minister questions, rather than godly edifying in faith, so do. Now, Pastor, now what is this endless genealogies? I'm glad for this, because whenever I get to the genealogies, I get bored, and so I don't like to read that part of the Bible anyway, so I'm going to put that in the Song of Solomon category now, and we won't pay attention to either of those things in the Scripture. No, that's not what the Scripture is teaching here. It's not what it's emphasizing. The idea of endless genealogies is here's the closest thing I can think of to illustrate it. Have you ever seen one of these numbers books? What's the middle letter in the Bible? How many, they count from the end of the Bible to the begin, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, and then they'll number their way back to the center, and they'll take the middle word, and they'll come up with a meaning for it. And sometimes it's kind of neat. It's like, oh, it's kind of cool. And then they get into, what does the number 3 represent? What does the number 7 represent? What does the number 6 represent? What is the number 13? Folks, none of those numbers are significant. 37 is the only significant number in the Scripture anyway. And so if you want to study numbers in the Bible, study Numbers 37. And that's a significant genealogy. Okay, that's a joke. It went right over everybody's heads. You smile, you laugh at it. Timothy is being instructed to teach the Word of God, not the things that aren't in the Word of God. Friend, if you read something neat into the Bible, read it right back out and then read the thing that the Bible says. That's the simple instruction here. In other words, I see something going on behind the scenes here. Listen, friend, if it's not there, don't read it in the Scripture. There's enough there for you to deal with. You don't have time for the endless genealogies. And the Bible goes on to say, there is those things minister questions. Whenever somebody comes to me with something neat, and by that I mean extra-biblical, extra. They come, Pastor, I found something neat. You know what my immediate response is? And I'm not talking about how I respond to them. I'm just talking about as I ponder their neat thought that they've been, they've been enlightened with that nobody else could find in a million years. As I think about that neat thing, the first thing that happens is, if that's true, then what about? Well, would that explain or would that contradict this other bit of material? And so that is the response that we find when we look at these kind of a situation. So we're instructed in the Scripture, don't be looking for the obscure, look for what's there. That's exactly what Paul tells Timothy. He says, I don't want these Bible classes that are teaching the things that nobody else could find. We're looking for the Scripture that teaches what's there. Christian, I'll tell you what's there, and you can just mark these things down, and you could focus on them. The gospel is there. The gospel is there. One of the most important teachings of the Scripture, the preeminent doctrine of the Scripture is Jesus Christ, and Jesus is the gospel. And if somebody wants to teach a series in some way, somehow, Christ does not have the preeminence, friend. You've taught something that's extra-biblical. It is endless genealogies. It's questions. And the Scripture says that, or they minister questions, rather than godly edifying, which is in faith. So now I want to look at the second part of verse 4. The contrast is that instead of those things, we are rather to teach godly edifying in faith. Now, we know what edify means, right? Edify is to build up the building or to build up the body in this particular instance. And what builds up the body is godliness. If our goal as Christians is to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ, and it is, that is our purpose in life. Our stated purpose in the Scripture over and over again is that we are predestinated to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. That is our purpose. God has predetermined before the foundation of the world that those who believe Him, believe in Jesus Christ, should be like Jesus. Now, I say this all the time, but it's so encouraging, it's hard to just skip over, but it is such a promise that is involved in this. It means we're on even ground. It means that everybody in the church has the same opportunity. Because God does not save us on the basis of our ability or disability. He doesn't save us on the basis of our background or on the basis of our accomplishments. He saves us on the basis of our need for a Savior, and that's all the same. We're on even ground. We're all sinners, and we've all come short of the glory of God. And so we come to Christ Jesus because we need to be saved. That is our reason for coming. And when we get saved, we get saved at different places, right? Our location when we're saved is different for every person. I was saved in a great location. I was out in the country, and nothing around but coyotes howling, and in the house, of course, but brushing my teeth, and I got saved shortly after that. I saw my need for Christ as Savior, and I got saved. That was my location. I was 4 years old. Now let me tell you a little bit of my circumstances. My parents had been saved several years before I was saved. And so I was saved in the home of Christian parents. I was saved in the home of conscientious Christian parents that actually had a desire, a heart's desire, that I would be raised in a way that I would live for Jesus. And so they were trying to do things in our life to raise me so that I would know God and that I would live for Jesus. And so many people look at me and they say, Pastor Price, I wish I had your background. I wish I'd been born into a Christian family that would have shared the gospel at me by the time I was four, I'd understand it well enough to see my need for a Savior. I wish I'd had parents that sent me to Christian school and had taken me to church and made me memorize Scripture and had encouraged me to go to Christian college and encouraged me to go into the ministry. I wish I had parents like that. I just want to tell you something. If you didn't, then too bad. You don't need them. You need the parents God gave you. You see, when the Bible says we're predestinated to be conformed to the image of Christ, it doesn't say based on where you started from, you'll achieve it more or less based upon the worthiness or on your background. No, the fact of the matter is that we're on even ground. We're all going to the same place and we'll all be at the same level. We went from being sinners to having the righteousness of Christ, and there's not a better righteous or a lesser. There's not a better sinner or a worse sinner. We went from having our individual backgrounds to God saying, as far as the east is from the west, so far hath He removed our transgression from us. That's glorious, isn't it? Amen. And there's not a person whose transgression is more greatly hidden than the other person. Amen. And so then we see that God says that our future is the same. And so this is where I have to be bold and say, stop making excuses. Your past has nothing to do with your future. Your past is forgiven, and God has removed it from you, and He's given you a future, and your future is the same as mine is. Your future is the same as the overachiever because God wants everybody to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. And that's a bright future. So there's nobody in this room that is specially advantaged. There's no one in this room that has special abilities. Friend, every one of us can have full fellowship and everything that pertains to it to serve the Lord Jesus Christ and to be like Jesus. Isn't that wonderful? It's a wonderful truth. Now, Paul goes on to say, though, that one of the things that we are to do as believers is that we are to have godly edifying, which is in faith. So Paul says, the fables and endless genealogies, they gender questions. But he is, in contrast, sound doctrine builds up and edifies in the faith. And this is where we need to focus our Bible study and our preaching. Our job as Christians is not to understand the obscure. Our duty as Christians is to know God and His will, His way, and His plan in our lives. A Christian, that's pretty simple. You know what you need from the Bible? You need answers for the things you're dealing with this week. You don't need to know things that nobody else knows. You ever been impressed with something somebody knew? Sometimes I meet interesting characters, and pretty often, actually. And many times, they want to convince me that they know the Bible, and so they've learned something somewhere. Somebody told them something that most people wouldn't pay attention to, or that's just from outer space. It isn't even in the Bible. And they want to ask you something, and the reason for it is because for them, it's a distraction from what they really need. Many people want to talk about spiritual things so they don't have to talk about their spiritual need. And so they know things, doctrine, they know Bible teaching, which is a distraction, if you understand what I'm saying this evening. And so they'll ask a strange question. I remember one man, so you're a Christian. So tell me, boy, how many heavens are there? Well, everybody knows there's three, right? But what in the world does that have to do with whether or not you need to be saved? You see what I'm saying? And as people say, well, what do you know about? And they'll ask some strange, obscure question. What were the sons of the... what were the names of the mighty men of David? Somebody, you know them, don't you, Brother Nick? Do you memorize the names?
Some of them. That's 30, yeah. 37.
Yeah. 37, yeah, of course. I didn't mean to give away the 37. All right. What were the names of the mighty men of David? And do you know that most of you guys don't know that? And I just want to tell you something. I'd rather you knew how to share the gospel. Here's the reason. The purpose of Bible teaching and Bible doctrine is not for the teacher to impress the student. It's not for the student to learn the obscure so he can feel that he is intelligent. It's for us to be able to live for Jesus Christ, and that edifies the body. I want to ask a practical question this evening, and you can sneer or make fun if you like to, or others can make fun of you if they like to. But what is important for Christians to know, the complex or the simple things? The simple. And what kind of people are we? Complex or simple? I heard a bunch of complexes. Who said that? Who's our complex people? I'm going to get you. All right. We're simple. Hey, admit it. I know, compared to, I don't know, somebody in here, you're complex, I'm sure. But compared to God, you're simple. Foolishness of God is wiser than men. The weakness of God is stronger than men. That's one of the things we need to remember. We need simple truth. We need practical truth. We need truth we can live. And so many people get off doctrinally because they ignore the simple and they emphasize the complex. So many individuals get off doctrinally because they're more into teaching strange doctrine than they are obeying Scripture. And we as Christians just need to simplify. We need to streamline the process of being like Jesus Christ. I'll tell you something we need in our church. We need to have a simple process where people can come to Christ, can learn foundational doctrine, can learn how to live holy, sanctified Christian living, and to have humility of spirit, and to serve the Lord Jesus Christ the rest of our days. We don't need to have individuals that can contend for the faith. with all the people that don't want to believe. We just need people that can share their faith and live their faith. We don't need great scholars. We don't need anybody in the world to look at us and say, wow, they're impressive, or to look at us and say, wow, they're really dumb. We don't need that. We just need to simply know the Word of God and sound doctrine. And Paul left Timothy behind to make sure they stayed on track. And God's given this church a pastor. He's given every church a pastor, and that's his duty. It's his job to make sure a church stays on track. And Christian, I want to encourage you by that. If God wants it, then it means it can be achieved. If God wants us to simply edify, He wants us to avoid genealogies and endless questions, then friend, that means our faith's not complicated, isn't it? And aren't you glad for that? Admit it. The simple way is the best way. And that's the faith wherein we stand. Heavenly Father, help us to believe your word. Help us to live in light of it. We thank you so much for the encouragement we find. God, I ask as we look at in the future at these warnings about false doctrine, that God, you would help us to be alert. Lord, help us to see plainly that although we may not be able to identify a false teacher, we can look at their fruits and know what they are. And Father, I pray that you would help us to live in light of that. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You're dismissed.